Good morning, everyone. Thank you so much for coming to the first in our 2016-2017 Food for Thought Lecture Series. We're just absolutely thrilled to have you here today. In spite of all the rain, and I know it's in conjunction with Alumni Weekend, can I see a show of hands for any Trinity alumni that are in the room? Thank you so much for coming, and I know you're going to have a great time for Alumni Weekend this weekend. As I said, this is our first in our Food for Thought Lecture Series this year, and we're so looking forward to having Jim Comer speak today on the joys and jolts of caregiving, parenting your aging parents. As he told me, it's a very serious topic, but it's not that I take it and present it seriously. So we should be in for a great, fun presentation today with Jim. But I want to give you a heads up on the upcoming Food for Thought Lecture Series. We'll have one November the 9th with Dr. Heather Sullivan, and it'll be in the Skyline Room in the evening from 5:30 to 7:30. And then on February the 8th, we're going a little off campus and having it off campus at Silo at 1604 to interest those constituents in that part of the world. And that will be with Jacob Tindall and Cabral Ferreira. They'll be talking about projecting results of competitive sports and March Madness. So that should be a lot of fun. And then we'll wrap it up on April the 6th. With Dr. Jenny Brown. She is the San Antonio Poet Laureate. We are very honored to have her as one of our professors here, and she'll be presenting Trinity Reads Poetry. So it should be great. And if you'd like to sign up for any of those, please see us in the back afterwards. It's my pleasure to introduce Barbara Ann Stevens to you. Barbara, you want to raise your hand? Barbara Ann loves Trinity, and she is a very proud graduate of Trinity from the class of 1966. She began her career in teaching and moved to nonprofit consulting after she raised her two boys. I have boys too, so that's just great. And she is very well respected for her expertise in nonprofit fundraising. And we're just so excited to have you here with us today. And it's going to be her pleasure to introduce her dear college friend, Jim Comer. Welcome.
Ago, this very weekend, we met at Trinity when we were entering freshmen, and Jim has gone on to distinguish himself in incredible ways as a communication specialist. He's an author of several books. He is a speech writer, so if those of you are called on to speak, Jim is your ghostwriter. He has worked with CEOs of Fortune 500 companies, training them and coaching them in speaking techniques. But what's the most important thing that Jim has done in his life is to parent his precious parents, and that's the topic we'll be talking about today. I wanted to share one personal story with you, and that is that my dad passed away from Alzheimer's. And Jim and I went through that together as he was caring for his parents. And when Daddy was diagnosed, the only thing that was available to people who were finding themselves getting ready to take this long journey that they called the long goodbye was a book called The 72-Hour Day. It was extraordinarily clinical. It was really, really big. I was flying someplace, I took the book with me, I read the first chapter, and I thought, I'm not going to be able to do this. This is hideous. This was horrible. This was the worst thought that I had. And how am I going to be able to walk with Daddy through this? And then Jim wrote his book. And the great thing about it, that those of us who've been through the journey can tell you, is there is joy in it. There are ways to do it and to not be overcome by it. And so I'm grateful for Jim's book. I have given it to many people who have found themselves in similar circumstances that I was experiencing. And it is my pleasure to introduce to you my friend, Jim Comer.
Thanks. Gosh, it's good to be in front of this group today. I'm looking around, there's so many friends and classmates, people I graduated with, people I've known me for 54 years, 50% of my life. So to be here today, as well as to welcome those who I don't know, and this is our first time to meet. Former First Lady Rosalind Carter said there are four kinds of people in the world. People who have been caregivers, people who currently are caregivers, people who are going to be caregivers, and people who are going to need caregiving. I've been in three of those groups. There's just one left, and you know what it is. Now, how about you? How many of you have already been a caregiver? Raise your hands. Whoa! Most of them. Okay, how many of you are currently, right this now, caring for somebody? Oh, good. Good. A good number of people here. Great. Anybody in the room know you're going to be a caregiver eventually and not yet? One, two? Oh, good. We got some of those, too. And I think those of us who are visiting with us on tape today, I'm sure there are many people who are going to be caregiving and wondering how they're going to do it. Hope this talk will help to answer that. Let's go back to February 20th, 1996. I'm living in Los Angeles writing speeches for a CEO. Sound asleep, 7 a.m., the phone rings. Oh, Lisa? Lisa Huff? Lisa Huff was my parents' next door neighbor in Dallas. In 34 years, she had never called me. My whole body braced for bad news, and it was in the next sentence. She said, Jim, your daddy's in the front yard, and he's wandering back and forth, and he looks like he's in a daze. I think he's having a stroke. Oh, hung up from her. I called home trying to get my father on the phone. And for the first time ever, he would not answer the phone. I could hear him yelling in the background, but he wouldn't come to the phone. And in that moment, I knew that Lisa's sidewalk diagnosis was correct. He was indeed having a stroke. And you know how they got into the hospital, the neighbors? They told him he was going for Mexican food. That's Texas, isn't it?
That's right. Yeah.
Well, I mean, I was on a plane within, 8 hours, heading for Dallas, where they lived. And I got off that plane, I went to the hospital where they'd gotten him. He was in intensive care. He couldn't walk, he couldn't talk, had no use of his bodily functions. My mother, who had early Alzheimer's, didn't even understand what was happening. And I had no brothers and sisters. That was it. Well, I walked in, I can still see it, walking into the hospital room with friends and neighbors and church members were there, and I can almost see them go, the man with all the answers is here. I didn't even know the questions because my father wouldn't talk to me. I've been trying to get him to talk for 5 years, and he would not discuss it. Anything about mother, or the future, or himself, he wouldn't leave the room. So I didn't know anything. And the hospital told me, you've got 1 week. 1 week here in this intensive care hospital, and you've got to have your dad in rehab. Well, I didn't know anything about rehab. But I didn't know it couldn't be in Dallas, because we didn't have any family in Dallas. You know, friends and neighbors are great, but family is essential. I had to get them down to Austin, where their aunts and uncles or their cousins, especially ones my age, would be the key to So I had to fly down to Austin in a rainstorm. My cousin met me at the airport. We went to 4 rehab places in one afternoon. I didn't know what to look for. I didn't have any idea what I was supposed to look for. You know how I made the decision? St. David's Hospital. A nurse smiled at me. I needed a smile really bad that weekend. And you know, that smile captured the entire St. David's healthcare system, was caught in that smile. And I chose that, about a $40,000 smile. And they said they would bring my daddy down the following Monday in an ambulance and put him in rehab. I said, great. And they said, Medicare would pay for it. I got home that night, told my mom about Medicare paying for it. She said, you think Medicare can afford it? I think my mom was ahead of the game, don't you? She had her running the government up there. Then, of course, she said, and if those of you who knew my mother know this, something about, now, Jim, I think it's just fine for Daddy to go down there. Just fine. But I am staying right here in Dallas. Of course, she couldn't stay in Dallas. He'd taken over everything. She couldn't live alone, but didn't know it. So I had to find a way to get her to Georgetown, right outside of Dallas, where my cousins, two sets of cousins, had a, well, they had absolutely guaranteed their eventual sainthood by agreeing to keep her. But I had to get her there. I didn't quite know what to do. Then I came up with a brilliant idea that I recommend to some of you. You'll want to use this. It's, I'm going to write this down. Therapeutic lying.
Yes.
Therapeutic lying. You're going to have to do some of that. So the night before Dad was going to go down, I packed for my mother. Those of you who know me know how good that was. I did the best I could. I took clothes. Trauma. And Monday morning, 8:30, she's sitting at her little breakfast table reading the Dallas Morning News, no coffee. I'm betting everything on this one. I go in and say, Mama, would you like to go get some ice cream? My mama never turns down ice cream, not even at 8:30 on a Monday morning. She smiled, put the paper down, got right up, and happily walked with me, got into the car, and we drove away from her home of 34 years. And she never saw it. Now, I don't want you to think I'm a bad guy. The first Dairy Queen we came to, stopped. I got her the biggest, gooeyest chocolate sundae you can imagine. And she was real happy with that. But somewhere around Waco, she must have known we were going on a longer trip. But by that time, with the Alzheimer's, she was already so focused on commenting on the colors of passing cars that she didn't seem to mind. We got to Georgetown. I left her with my cousins, kissed her goodbye, and rushed to the airport. I'd been gone 11 days. And I'd already used my vacation for that. I just had a kind boss who said, go do what you had to do. I was going to do it anyway. And they kept paying. Got back to LA, and I knew that my life had changed forever. 2 weeks later, I'm back to check out Dave. Go up to the fourth floor of rehab, walk into his room, there he is, still can't walk, talk, use his bodily functions, but his eyes are good and his mind is good. He takes one look at me, and I watched him force out 3 words. Me pills. I knew he didn't mean aspirin. What kind of pill do you think you want me to get? Pain? No. No. Worse than what pain? What thing might you want me to do? What? Thank you. Got it, Christine. He wanted me to get him pills that would end his life. He did not want to hang around dependent. Well, that was not the first question I was expecting. And of course, my father, on top of everything, death. So all of our conversations were bellowed forever. So I go, Dad, I can't do that. I'll go to jail. No, not hell, Dad, jail! Maybe both. I don't know. I cannot do it. Well, he didn't like that answer. But so what I did was I went to a doctor, one of his doctors, and I said, is there anything we can do to restore his bodily functions? I know that's driving him crazy. He said, there's an operation, maybe, 50-50. I said, well, let's go for it. And so we got to sign the form, and they did the operation. And about 2 or 3 weeks later, my daddy could go to the bathroom unassisted, and he decided he wanted to live. That one thing had made all the difference. Good thing I didn't get in those pills, right? So I fly home thinking, well, so we got past that one. He wants to live. And, you know, I'm thinking things are maybe going okay. And then, oh, I don't know, 3 or 4 weeks later, I get a call, my first parent-teacher call. I've never had kids, so I never had a call. I may have been the subject of some, but I've never had one. This is St. David's Rehab. Mr. Cumber, sorry to tell you this, but we have to expel your father. For bad behavior. He's been yelling at the nurses. Well, they weren't giving me an option here. They were throwing him out in a week. I'd fly back in again. And by this time, I knew that my mother was driving my cousins crazy, although they hadn't said that. But I knew. So I needed a place like assisted living for her, skilled nursing for him. And I had Friday till Monday to make this happen. I went to the only place in Austin at the time, Suzanne, you remember? I think you and I actually went there together. It was the Summit, right near the Colorado. They had a continuum of care, which 20 years ago was not common. And I walked in, and in my innocence, not knowing how difficult this would be, I went to the admissions and I said, I need to get my mom and daddy in here on Monday. They looked like I lost my mind. But they humored me. Missions director to me and said, well, let's just see what we've got available. She's going through this big book that four computers are all. She's going through this giant book. And all of a sudden she goes, oh, well, we have openings. And we have openings on Monday. She starts jumping up and down like we've won the sweepstakes. Well, of course, we have. I just was too innocent and too new to know that. We got them in on Monday. I was even able to go up to Dallas and get some of Mama's furniture for her room. Got him in, flew back to LA. One more time, I think we got it. But over the next 3 or 4 months, the calls kept coming, the problems kept coming. I realized I couldn't do what needed to be done from 1,000 miles. I just couldn't. I couldn't foist it off on my cousins. They each had 3 kids and jobs. And so I had a choice. Either bring my folks out to LA, where they didn't know anybody and had no support system with me, or quit my good job, leave my friends and church and life that I've built up over 13 years, and move back to Texas, where I had lived in 30 years. Had no network, no business. Not the easiest choice. But you know, I really did choose to parent my parents. And I must tell you, for a guy who'd been completely self-involved forever, it was the best choice I ever made. Now, I'm going to stop right there. And I want to tell you, it didn't have to be this hard. Those first 6 months could have been easier if I'd done a couple of things. Now, Woody Allen says that showing up is 80% of life. Well, I showed up. But I didn't have a plan. I didn't have any knowledge. So over the years, I developed 50 questions that will save you time, money, and tears. And I put them in this book with places to write the answers. Because gosh, if I had those questions answered and I'd had a game plan, everything would have been easier. And so you might ask yourself, why is it that most people, including some maybe in this room, have not talked to their parents, their siblings, or in some cases, their children, and made a game plan, had a conversation where you talk about everything? Well, the reason is the book
cost, often, you know, for some students. We don't like things to be, we like things nice and smooth and easy, right? And yeah, it may be a difficult conversation. They may get angry, they may not want to do it, there may be some yelling and some crying, I don't know. On the other hand, they may be very happy that you finally brought the subject up. You won't know unless you have the conversation. Two things that I want you to remember, baby, this is one of them. Have the conversation. And if you've already done it with your parents, you need to have it with your children. You need to talk about everything you want and don't want. All the financial, all the end-of-life decisions, everything. And if you do that, you're going to go into caregiving way ahead of the game, unlike me. Now, I'd like to, of these 50 questions, I'm going to just mention two, ask you two questions. Do you, for those of you who are don't yet, already still in caregiving, do you know if your parents have a will? Everybody knows that their parents have a will, right? And do you have a will? Everybody, let's see all the hands if everybody has a will. Oh my goodness, but hold on, keep it up. This is the first, I see one hand that's not up. Oh my God, you broke the record. This is the highest percentage of wills in the history of this speech for 10 years. Usually it's 50%. I'm not kidding. We have one person. So I'm glad that we're gonna give you a little urging to have a will. I gotta tell you, wills are essential. So I'm so glad you've got it. And that means I'm sure that you've all got powers of attorney, right? Very important. You've also got end of life decisions, advanced directives, all those things, burial plans, even if what you want or don't want at your funeral. I gotta tell you, if at my funeral, if someone's saying, you light up my life, I'm gonna sit down and zap them. I mean it. So I'm gonna hear everything written. You know, my father, when I finally brought the subject up of funerals, it took me forever. I was on chapter 12 of the book, Funerals, when I finally got the courage to talk to my father. Big deal, and he could not have been less concerned. And he said, Jim, do what you want to do. I'm not going to be there. He said, funerals are for the living. Well, he's right. Now, some of us have some other thoughts. I have a lot to say. So have those things done. Well, I'm so thrilled that this is a willed group. Because, you know, some people don't. Prince, $300 million estate, 56-year-old man who had health problems for decades, no will. A bunch of brothers and sisters, that's not going to be pretty. I'm just going to tell you that right now. Okay, second question. This is, I guess, for many of you, it will be about your children. Some of you, it will be about your brothers and sisters and parents. Do you know, if you're still going to care for your parents, do you know which of your siblings is going to help you care? You know who's going to show up? And you know who's going to be missing in action? You know. And how about those of you who are parents? Think of your children now, those lovely children that you raised so well. Do you know who's going to show up for you? Do you? And do you know who's probably not? Oh, good, that's it. Yeah, this one knows. Right here, you know. She is right in the middle of it, so she knows. Because, let's just be honest, in most families, not everybody's going to show up. My friend Mary in Austin had a father. Father died. Mother lived a couple more years, and then she got sick. Mother got sick, and it was going to be an illness that went on for a while. As soon as the mama got sick, Mary's only sibling, her sister, took a teaching job in Auckland, New Zealand, as far as you can go in a minute. I mean, that's how far away she was. I was just in Auckland about 3 weeks ago. It's far. It is seriously far. She never said, I'm not going to be part of mama's care. She just went 12,000 miles away where she could not be any help. Mary had to do it all for the next 5 years. So my question to you, Is there an Auckland person in your family? You need to know so you can plan around that. You need to know that early. You don't need to be surprised by it. Now, I didn't have to worry about siblings when I showed up in Austin, Texas, 20 years ago yesterday, with my U-Haul, and one friend who came to make sure I made it. Yeah, I didn't worry about that. I was worried about dealing with mother's Alzheimer's because I hadn't been around it. Just, you know, a few days at Christmas, a few days in the summer. But I didn't really know what that was about. And boy, did I find out this. First of all, she had about 60 dresses in her closet. She'd only wear 5. Jim, I can't wear that. It's stolen.
Stolen?
Mother, I gave that to you for your 50th wedding anniversary. No, you didn't. It's stolen. I don't want to get. You don't want me to get. They'll put me in the Who Scout. Only my mother would say the word Who Scout. You know she would, right? So I was like going, logic is not working here. You know, she was beyond going to logic. Then came the day. Mother wanted to go see her sister, Estelle, who lived in Smithville, about 60 miles away. And I made a really stupid rookie caregiver mistake. I said, Mama, we can't go to see Estelle. She's in heaven. Big mistake. Mama started crying as if she'd never heard that news before. Estelle had been dead for 8 years. But it was news to my mother in that moment. She began sobbing, and her shoulders were heaving, and tears coming. She cried for 15 minutes. I just thought, oh my gosh, what did I do? So I made an appointment right away. The next day, I saw an Alzheimer's specialist. I don't know how I got in the next day, but I got there quick. And I said, what am I going to do? I don't know how to handle this. And she said, well, honey, you don't have much choice. I didn't have much choice. I said, well, how do I deal with this? And she said, here's the deal. Quit trying to drag your mother into your world. She can't go there anymore. She can't go there. Instead, you must go into your mother's world. Go into her world. That was the single best piece of advice I ever got about caregiving, by far. And I got it. I got it that day, and I started using it and living by it that day, and I lived by it for the next 14 years of caregiving. Because when I arrived, Mother was here. She was still pretty sharp. I mean, she was repartee and funny, and she was pretty still sharp. Not good memory, but funny and great too. As time went by, she kept losing cognitive ability, and I would try to match where she was. And then when things happened and health got worse, I'd continue to try to match. When she was in a wheelchair, I'd match. And then when the day came, when I arrived, and she didn't know who I was. Now, many of you have probably experienced that. Not an easy moment. But it's not about me. It's about her. She's not forgetting me. Her disease is forgetting me. So what I did was I just started my business. Hi, Mom. Jim Comer, your firstborn. Nice to see you. And I'd visit with her, and pretty soon she liked this strange person that was coming to see me. And we do what we could. And as time went by, she began to be less coherent and kind of more gibberish. And so when she was doing a job, I would try to find a word and go with whatever word I could hear and talk about that. And then eventually, she couldn't talk at all the last few days. So we did a lot of, in a wheelchair, we went to the garden a lot because she loved that garden. Mm-hmm. I never did like gardens, but I learned to. And she loved to hear birds, and she loved us. So I did what made her happy, because that's all I could do. And that's what I urge you to do. But here's the thing I don't want anybody to do. Do not criticize Your parents may forget things or repeat things. Or anybody else that you're caring for. I mean, we've all seen this person, a well-meaning adult child with a parent, an older parent who's got memory issues. And the parent repeats something. And, well, let me give you my example. Better get back. My mother remembered that I was infamous for running out of gas. She really had that D in her. So every time I would come to see her when she was at independent living, and, oh, by the way, my father had a complete recovery, so they did get into independent living. Yeah, they came into independent living. And he talked the people at the Methodist retirement home into letting mother in as a trial case. She didn't belong there, but he was a salesman. So,
that's right.
They had moms there. Yeah, so. It's, you know, it's so important. So every time I come to see mother, she, first thing she'd say, Jim, how are you fixed for gas? Don't you lie to your mom, you have gas in that car? Yes, mama, I just filled it up. Exxon, just there, totally full. She wasn't sure about that. So she knew I had lied twice before. So she might repeat that same question 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 times in one visit. And my job was not to correct her, but to answer without comment or facial expression, but say, yes, mom, full tank, just filled her up, yes, yep, yeah, got gas. As many times as she asked, I answered without judgment. Because most people do what I was about to show you, which is the mother repeats themselves, or the father repeats themselves for the sixth time, and the caregiver breaks, goes, I just told you that. Don't you remember? I just said that. I don't you remember? No. If they remembered, they wouldn't ask the question. I mean, you wouldn't say that to someone with cancer. You wouldn't say, I told you to get rid of that tumor. I told you last week 3 times, and you've still got it. Would anybody say that? No, but we have no problem saying that to someone with memory loss. So do not do it. Even when you want to, or it's driving you crazy, don't do that. It's not kind. See, we want our parents to be the way they were, right? We want them to remember the way we were. So when you're faced with a choice between them being right and you being kind, go for kind every time. You cannot go wrong. By being kind. And I think that I was about a 98 on that. Did pretty well occasionally, but I really tried to do it. Now, let me tell you about my sense of humor, which made everything so much easier. She was funny. You know.
I do.
Several of you know. Claudia's nodding back there, Jean. For example, here's one day I walked into a room, my shoes were scuffed up. Unlike the beautiful polished job I did today. Mother, you'd be so pleased. Anyway, I walked into her room. She looked at those shoes. She had great eyes. She said, Jim, those shoes are a scandal to the jailer. Has anybody ever heard that expression? It's deep East Texas. And it means not good. I said, Mother, no, don't worry. I'm going to get new shoes when I'm rich. And she scrunched up her face and said, oh, Jim, don't wait that long. I wonder how she knew. Anyway, then my favorite line ever that she said, there was a gentleman in the independent living facility who just thought my mother was terrific. And he thought she was hot. That's right. She was a young 84, he was 90. So every time I went into the lobby and he was there, he'd stop me, rave on about my mother. Just could not say enough about it. This happened over and over again. So finally, I thought, well, Mama needs to know she has an admirer. So I said, Mother, did you know there is a 92-year-old man who thinks you are terrific? And she said, honey, that's the kind I attract. This comes with a woman who's had Alzheimer's for 10 years. Still had the one-liners. Is that great? So I was like, then there was my father,
No. Death, demanding, defiant, and I had no idea how much he liked his scotch. He didn't just like it, he liked it. And he found a World War II buddy who lived on the second floor. He and Mother were on the fourth floor. They had rooms right next to each other. And he found this World War II buddy, and he would go down many nights to the second floor, and they would refight the war and drink a little, that's a lie, drink a lot of scotch. And then around 11 o'clock or so, when Berlin had fallen yet again, and Hitler had committed suicide, my father, do it this way, my father would go down that long, long, wall-to-wall carpeted hallway, and he'd be trying to get to the stairs so he could go up to his room. But a couple of times, he looked down at that carpet, and it just looked so appealing. He just couldn't help himself. He just had to take a little tiny pause, just a little tiny out. Well, I mean, of course, somebody came along. They saw that, and they thought, dead, heart attack, another stroke. They called front desk called EMS, EMS sent the ambulance, ambulance rushed him to the emergency room, doctor is waiting, diagnosis, bombed. Happened twice in 1 year. Now you remember, he'd been kicked out of another place already. Remember that? Of course, I got a parent-teacher call after both of those instances. I was so worried that he would get kicked out of this one. So I made an appointment with the one of the big executives there. And I took him to lunch. I said, well, what do we do about Dad's drinking? And I can still remember the answer. He turned to me and he said, you know, your father did such great service in World War II with 75 missions. And he's taking such good care of your mother. He allows her to stay here. He does a great job caring for her. That's not easy. He's 90 years old. He's caring for your mother. So if he needs a little scotch to do it, it's okay with me. This is a Methodist retirement home. I couldn't believe it. I was thrilled. Now, I won't mention any names, but think of another large denomination in Texas. If we had been in their home, what would happen? Wah! Out the door. Likely. Now, I've got to tell you, but I just did the thing of the foot. When you're a speaker, everything happens. I was at a very fancy restaurant in Austin, 100 people there, super fancy, and I did the kick and did not realize the shoe was on top. That shoe soared in the air. It must have gone, to me, 60 feet up. Maybe it didn't. But it felt like that. The entire audience was watching the shoe go up. Then, of course, it began to go down. I thought, oh, it's going to fall on somebody. Lost it. What it missed, everybody. I got the single biggest laugh ever recorded in this speech. And actually, when I was signing books, a woman came and brought me a lovely napkin with my foot insert in it. That's just what I had to tell you that. So, you know, my father, you know, I didn't know what to do exactly. So I didn't do anything until one night I came to get him to do some event, and he was in his chair watching Lawrence Welk, probably, and he'd already had he couldn't get out of the chair. That wasn't good. I thought the time has come. Can't be happiness, because he has to then go try to get out and walk, you know. So I thought, well, I'm just going to get rid of the one bottle of, Well, I looked in his closet, 2 half gallons behind the boots. Well, they didn't come for me.
So I didn't know who they came from. I didn't know how he was getting this stash. You know, I asked, this is just another tip. The maid on the floor is a source of all knowledge. I asked the maid. She knew exactly. The guy he used to go see on the second floor had moved out, but he kept coming to see my father. And when he came, he brought the scotch. And I said to the maid, you don't have any chance to know his name and phone number. She said, oh yeah, absolutely. Really? She gave me the number. I called the guy, I said, Dad is cut off. That day, he was watching TV in that bigger room, and I took the scotch out into the hall. He didn't see me, and just never said a word about it. And he never said a word about it. Big on communication there, Emma. Anyway, I don't know what he thought, but the scotch was gone, and there was no more kind. And life went on. But you see, you have to improvise. This is not a by-the-book thing, caregiving. You have to use a lot of improvisation, intuition, humor, trying things that may or may not work. You know, for everything I tried that did work, there were probably two or three things that didn't work. But you've got to be willing to try. Improvise. You know, act again. This could be, caregiving could be your Meryl Streep moment. This may be your chance. Because you've got to do something. Okay, so Dad is there, Mom's there. 5 years we have an independent living. Things are going well. I'm thinking, I've got this down. Got this down. No problem. Well, Christmas Eve 2000. Oh, do I have to tell you one more? A little surprise. One day, having lunch with them, Sunday lunch, the best time to go to see someone in any kind of long-term care facility is Sunday lunch. That's the best food. Tell you that right now. I'm there, I'm about to take my first bite of this wonderful chop they had. I had the fork right here, and my father was sitting next to me in his loud voice. He said, Jim, I need you to give me an enema after lunch. I did not sign up for enemas. Let's just say I did not enjoy that lunch. And it turns out that my enema giving skills left a lot to be desired. He never asked me to do that again. Those are the kind of things that happen. They just happen. You got to roll with them. Okay, so Christmas Eve 2000. My mother gets up in the middle of the night to go to the bathroom, falls, breaks her hip. Again, I get a 7 a.m. call, rush to the hospital. They do surgery on Christmas Eve. And the next day, while she's still in that fog of, you know, all the anesthetic, they've taken her false teeth, which she's had for 30 or 40 years. They put them on the tray, and they take the tray and put it in the dumpster. In a period of 2 days, she's lost the ability to walk and to chew. And we did everything to find those teeth that we could. 7 months later, on July 4th, big on holidays that year, my father fell on the way to the bathroom in the middle of the night and broke his hip. Same doctor, same operation, same hospital. They both ended up in skilled nursing. We skipped assisted living because they needed more help. Now, they went, by the way, from $2,000 a month total cost in independent living to $8,000 a month in skilled nursing, and that's back in. That's 15 years ago. It would be way over that now. So, I mean, everything changed. My father was determined that he was going to do all the exercises. And he was going to, he was, you know, this and that. He was doing everything he could to get back to independent living. And we held firm. I wanted him to make it. And he tried. He kept telling me, I'm getting it, I'm getting it. Well, after 2 months, the staff came to me and said, no, he's not. Can't dress himself. He can't always make it to the toilet. He just can't. He can't get it. He needs to stay here in nursing. He needs nursing care. He's 91 and a half years old. And he's just not going to be able to do it. Whew! This was not the news I wanted to hear. So they said, you need to tell your daddy. So I had to tell him that he had to stay in skilled nursing. And he was depressed. And I was depressed. So I went to the medical director and I said, could we have a little Prozac? And they said, oh yeah, we'll be happy to get your dad some Prozac. I said, not my dad, me, both of us. And they said, oh, okay. And they did, they gave me a little Prozac. And it helped. So dad finally made peace with the nursing home. And I put mother on A wing when she went in. I put him on B wing. Because he tended to boss her, which he needed to do back in independent living. He didn't need to boss her in the nursing. She had plenty of people taking care of her. So I kept, and I would have them meet in neutral territory. Because really, he couldn't hear and she couldn't remember, so they didn't have a lot to talk about. But they would meet and hug and do their whatever they did.
But they didn't eat together.
What? Oh, God, no, they didn't. She was in high intensity health. Yeah. He could eat at the main dining room. Mm-hmm. No, and he had many a partner there. He outlasted about 10 partners over the next 5 years. So.
Including my mom.
Right, your mom's there.
Yeah.
Phoebe knows this place.
Yep.
Okay, so, yes. So, you know, mother really liked being on her own. It was the first time in 60 years of marriage that she had been independent. And she liked it. And I wouldn't have messed with that. Well, on her 90th birthday, I thought, well, we're going to have a party. And I hired a piano player and a singer, and we had all the family, and oh, we had a party. And I thought, well, it's time for Dad to discover anyway. So I get him, and it's a big, big place. And I'm wheeling him, oh, just many hallways and many turns. And, we're at A-Wing's party, we go to the cab to party. It is terrific. So much fun. There must have been 50 wheelchairs there. Everybody. And at the end of the party, you know, because you're, even though you may be in your 50s or whatever, you never cease to want that parental approval. So I turned to my dad at the end of the party and I said, well, Dad, how did you like my mom's party? This is a direct quote. Well, it was all right except for all the old people. He was 91 and a half, but he was not an old people. So, here's what I didn't get. I had no idea. I'd forgotten how brilliant he was and his memories. The next day, he had memorized the route to Mother's room in one time. It took me several times to get it, but he memorized it the first time. The next morning, Monday morning, during the lunch rush, he goes all the way, finds his way to Mother's room, and grabs her wheelchair and starts pulling. I want you to come to my room! He's trying to get her back to his room. He wants to take care of her again. She's screaming, no, no, help, no! Trays are being knocked down. Oh, it's a chaos. I get, what do I get, Linda? Parent. Jim, your daddy is raising hell in A-Wing. What are you going to do about it? Improvisation. Another improvisational moment. I wrote out new rules for the nursing home. Mother is happy in A-Wing. They're taking good care of her. She doesn't need you to worry about her. She's perfectly okay. She can't wander. You don't have to worry about other stuff like that. Big font. I rushed up there. Got my father to put his glasses on, he put his hearing aids, which he never wore. He would drop them in the soup, but not wear them. I mean, had him read the question back and forth to me. And I said, well, Dad, do you understand? He said, of course I understand. I said, well, good. He said, I only want one thing. I want this piece of paper you brought me to be signed by the commandant. Thought, well, his military background. He means the nursing home administrator, the head guy. And so I went to his office. He was in a meeting. I said, there is an emergency. I need you now. And he really came. And he signed the thing in front of my dad. And we made a Xerox copy, gave it to Dad. He kept it in the drawer by his bed. And he never bothered my mother again. He really did it. because that commandant said so. See, he was used to that military chain of command. So that was another one that we dodged. But again, I didn't know that was going to work. I had to try it. Just as when in all those of you who've been caregivers, you know how many things you have to try before you sometimes get the thing that works. And professional caregivers, the same thing. Well, we went on, and they were there. Mother was in skilled nursing for almost 10 years, and Dad was there for 6. And they went, of course, to all their money. But fortunately, Medicaid came through, and they were able to stay. I want to end by telling you of my favorite story. How much time I've got? Oh, 15. Okay, good. Perfect timing here. My very favorite story. First of all, I want to say that I got more than I gave as a caregiver. I really did. I'd spent my whole life trying to be rich and famous in New York, in LA, pushing myself, trying to, you know, I was the center of my universe. And suddenly, I had to learn a new word called unselfish, new to my vocabulary. And it's a good word to learn. So, I'll borrow this, because I, as you know, move around and get you. I feel better. Okay. I learned that dignity comes in many shapes, including bent and wrinkled and walker-assisted. I learned that patience is the currency of love. And I had not always been the most patient person. And I learned to get out of myself and do what was best for them. My favorite example about this is taking my dad to the air show. Told you, he flew B-17 to World War II back in 43 when the casualty rate on his base in England was 80%. Kept a journal, which later became a best-selling book. So when they had the Georgetown air show every year, we went. And it was always in June. Hotter than hell, you know, 100 degrees and humidity. Oh my goodness. But we went. This was actually right before he broke his hip. He'd fallen and he was still walking. He was that period between mother going in and he was still at the other place. He was on a walker. And I thought, oh God, not taking it to the air show on a walker. They keep the B-17 a mile down the runway. It'll take forever. So I thought, well, say anything. And then when I was at dinner with him, we're walking back to his room, and we go by a billboard. You know what was on the billboard, don't you? Air show next week. Well, I knew that Eagle Eye Comer had seen that. And so I had no choice but to turn to my father, who was not wearing his hearing aid, and say, Dad, would you like to go to the air show next week? And he turned to me as only a parent can. And he said, oh, Jim, I don't know. Only if you want to go. therapeutic line. Yes, Dad, I'd love to go. I lied. So we made an appointment, 2:00 on Saturday. I showed up. Full tank of gas, on time. I walk into the front room, they say, oh, there was my dad. And the receptionist said, you know, he has been here for 45 minutes. He didn't want to be late. And he said, you know, the lady said, you know, he's been talking of nothing but the air show all week long. And I was about to not let it go. So we go to the car, and then of course, into the front seat. This is when I wish I was taller than 5'7", and getting it in, then trying to close the wheelchair without losing a finger. Very important one. Many a finger is gone. Then I'm trying to get the wheelchair into the trunk. He's honking the horn. Jim, let's take it so long. I'm trying to keep my calm. Get it in. Drive to the air show and get as close to the box office as possible. Then we have to do the whole thing.
out, get it in, and we go up to the ticket booth. And at that moment, I had one of my few brilliant thoughts. Don't have it very often. I looked at the ticket taker, and my father, of course, was wearing, even in the heat, his 8th Air Force jacket and cap. I thought, I'm going to use this. I said, do you know that you're standing in front of a World War II hero? 75 combat missions in a B-17. Well, she couldn't believe it, you know, because they sent them. Okay. So anyway, she couldn't believe it. She almost clicked her heels. And then she said the magic words, words I will never forget. She said, bring on the golf cart! Yeah! Thank you, Jesus! Oh, God, golf cart! That meant we weren't going to have to walk! Oh. I don't know if my father was thrilled, I was ecstatic. So the golf cart for VIPs comes. I get Dad, his folding chair, his water bottle, everything. Walker, get in the back seat. I sit in the front seat with the young soldier from Fort Hood, who was assigned to drive us. And we take off, and we're going, we are, I thought we hadn't gone 50 feet, and there's this giant thunder. I look up at the skies, which have turned black. Because I've been so focused looking down, I wasn't looking at the skies. We're about to have this giant thunderstorm. So I said to the young man, I said, you've got to get us to B-17, hurry, we've got to go fast, we've got to get to B-17, my father's food, 75 missions, we got to... Well, I kind of overreacted. I know you find that hard to believe. I got a little excited. But he heard. And he turned. He sped up and he turned to me and said, did you say 75 missions? Did they send us home after 25? I said, they did. But my father re-enlisted. And he went back for another 50. This guy just like, you couldn't believe it, he'd drive along, he said. Then he turns to my father, sit back here. He goes, sir, you are my hero. And of course my father, with no hearing aids, did not get a word of that. And I knew it, I know his routine. He went. Which means I don't have any idea what you just said, but I know you meant well. So I turned to him and I said, oh, that was such a nice thing to say. I really appreciate it. But you know, Dad is profoundly deaf. He just didn't hear any of it. And so I said, if you're around the ear, you'd have to go to the depths of your diaphragm, you'd have to bellow. He said, oh, I can do that. I said, really? He said, oh yeah, get ready, I'm gonna try it. So he said, sir! You are my hero! The entire air show heard it, including my father. Well, he just beamed. And we're driving along, and I see the airplane, and Dad says, Jim, look at her! Isn't she beautiful? And I said, yeah, Dad, she really is. And about that time, I felt the first drops. And just as the sky opened up to a thunderstorm of biblical proportions, we slid under the wings of the B-17.
Wow.
I mean, that thunderstorm went, and all 10,000 air show attendees were soaked to the bone. Not us. We were sheltered by the wings of the B-17. Got Dad out, got his folding chair up, got him into it, and pretty soon the crew heard about this veteran and they came down from the plane and stood in line to shake my Dad's hand. One of them even asked for an autograph. And I just moved back and let him spend his time with these veterans. He was in heaven. And about 20 minutes later, the rain stopped, and we went over, got his chair, we went over to the side, sat, and
We were surrounded by the plains of his departed youth. You know, I could see him almost in 1943. Lean, tan, bright blue eyes, his whole future ahead. It was my very favorite moment in 14 years of caregiving. And you know something? We didn't say a word, as far as I remember. Because perfect moments don't require words. They just are. But you don't get the perfect moments unless you show up for all of the moments. Good, bad, tough, challenging, painful, hysterical, all of them. It's a mixed bag. And you gotta show up for all of it to get the best of it. But I'm here to tell you, the best is worth it. Now, there's my mom. I gotta give you this line of hers. Mama loved to tell people, you know how much it cost me to stay in the hospital at Seton in Austin when Jim was born? You know what you cost me? $4 a day. And he's been worth every penny of it. So she said that all the time. But she got a laugh, and she knew it. She knew the laugh was coming. And so I spent 14 years trying to live up to that $4 investment. I think I might have made it. I don't know. Maybe I'm 3 to 80 or something. I'm close. What I want to leave you with is this. You know, a lot of people fear caregiving. A lot of people run from it. And I'm telling you that it doesn't have to be a negative experience. It is a part of the full experience of life. And I think that for those who show up and embrace it, it can be a wonderful thing, a necessary thing. I mean, I've had friends who ask me, how did you do that for 14 years? Didn't you resent it? Weren't you angry at your parents? I said, no, I didn't. I mean, it was tough. It wasn't easy, but I did not resent it. I grew from it. I really did. I grew up in my 50s and 60s. It took me a while. You know, Wordsworth said, the best part of a good person's life are the little unremembered acts of kindness and of love. Well, caregivers get so many opportunities for those. And glad I didn't miss them. Don't want you to miss them. Don't want you to have your children miss them. You know, I believe that caregiving is God's work. And then we show up and do the best we can, even how imperfect it may be, do the best we can. We are letting God's light shine through us. Thank you so much. So the earlier you can have this conversation and get everybody informed and have them know what they want and what they don't want. Because if you don't tell your children what you want, they're going to do what they want. I want you to tell them, I want you to get from your parents what they want. The only way to do that is have that conversation. It's the key. In this book, you know, I've got 50 questions, and about 2 years ago, I was doing this talk, and the director, the administrator of the Wesleyan home, she's got 400 people under her. She's the head person now. She came up to me after she got a book, and then she said, I need to talk to my parents. She said, I'm going to talk to them on Sunday. She took the book and went over the questions with her parents that Sunday. She called me the next week. She said, Jim, I just didn't realize how much I didn't know. And this is a person who's been an administrator for 20 years. Just because you're a professional in this world does not mean that you know everything. There's lots of stuff that we need to talk that can only come from conversation. So I urge everybody to do that. Another question. Somebody's got a question here. No? Somebody? Okay. Nothing. Good for you.
Can you talk about hospital-induced delirium?
Beg your pardon?
Hospital-induced delirium. She ended up in the hospital. They kept her too long. And she thought she was at the theater, and the nurses were coming to serenade her. And I mean, she went.
Well, that happens. Had she just been given some sort of operation or something?
No, she was in overnight. She bumped her head.
I see. That can happen after. That kind of thing.
The doctor left her there for an extra day. That extra day.
Wow.
Twisted her.
Well, you know, that can happen, especially after operations when they give them the anesthetics. They go. If they're older with the anesthetics, you'll have 2 or 3 or 4 days where they'll be way out and you couldn't say anything. And it happens with Alzheimer's or dementia. It could happen with overnight stay. It can happen at any time. And what you need to do is to try to settle, you know, do whatever you can medically to settle them down. And again, realize that this is going to pass. It did pass, right? How long did it take?
For the most part, we also found that in town here in San Antonio, the Christa Santa Rosa Hospital and Medical Center has training their nurses and their staff has training, and they know to identify these patients and get them in, get them sorted out, and get them out ASAP.
Okay, that's
so it doesn't happen.
So that's what's important for you as a caregiver to do your homework. All long-term care facilities are not created equal. God knows, right? They vary enormously, and also. They vary from day to day, even the good ones. If 2 or 3 key nurses don't show up on a day, for whatever reason, a good place is not good that day. You need to know that. You need to do your homework on long-term care and on hospitals. Hospitals vary enormously in their rates of infection and in picking up these horrible bugs that kill people. They're all over the place in their standards. Do the homework. Find out if they have these guys. How do they treat elderly people? How do they treat people with dementia? Are they prepared like that? The more you know about any place you send a loved one, the better off you are. And too many people just, you know, doctors say, oh, send them to so-and-so. They'll just do what the doctor says without doing any homework. You don't have to do what the doctor says. You can say, I'm not sure. Let me get back to you on that. You have to learn to stand up for yourself and for your parents. Because lots of times, there's relationships between medical professionals that have nothing to do with good care of patients. It has to do with financial things. Don't let them bully you in any way. Stand up for them. Beth knows about that. You get to do a lot of that with your husband. Sometimes it's husbands, not parents. Sometimes it's children. This can be all kinds of things. But you've got to do your homework. The more homework you do, the better off you are. Yes,
Bob. Jim, where can people get a copy of your book?
Oh, what a nice man. You tell that he is in PR. That is such a sweet thing to say. Well, Mike, I'm glad you asked that. That's the kind of thing they'll be saying on Sunday night at the debate. Oh, I'm glad you asked that, right? Yeah, it'll be right back at that table. Yes, I'll be saying. And what I love to do is to talk to you and sign something specific to whatever situation you're in, or if you want to give it to someone. You may need know people who need this book. Because they're facing this, or they're not facing this. That's right.
especially the ones you know who need to be talking to their parents and aren't. That, what a good gift to be for them. Art for children. Many a time I bought books for children, people have bought books for their kids, and I signed, "Take good care of your parents. Warmest regards, Jim Cohen." What a little spur to it there. So I'd be happy to sign books, and I thank you all for being here today and being such a great audience. And to see so many faces from my youth. Oh my, it's great to be here. Thanks so much.